How should we connect devices to our home network? Wireless or wired? Do these new boards from TTGO and Olimex change anything? Interesting questions. Let's have a closer look. Gritty YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. We all know wireless IoT devices are cool, but they have some drawbacks. This is why we want to look at the alternative, wired IoT devices. What are the pros and cons of both technologies? Which cables do I have to use for my home network and why? What do I have to know if I want to crimp my own Ethernet cables? How does the ESP32 support Ethernet and which boards are available? What is the downside of using Ethernet on the ESP32? How complicated is it to change a wireless sketch to a wired one? Of course, we create an example to test if it works as an MQTT sensor and actuator. Wireless is fascinating to me since I was young. It has many advantages, like no cables to deploy and the flexibility to freely move everywhere in the range of the device. But wireless also has disadvantages. Because information moves through the air, it is prone to hacking and interference. A proof? All modern armies have an electronic warfare department. Its throughput is limited because all devices within reach have to share the same channels. In addition, the faster a connection, the more bandwidth it needs and the more power we need for a transmission. If you want to know more about wireless communication, watch videos number 219 and 221. Wired connections are simpler, faster, and more energy efficient for short ranges. Because they use a star topology, they have fewer resources to share. Wired connections are hard to hack if you do not have physical access. For me, as a rule of thumb, I use wired connections where possible. My PC and my Raspberry server are connected with Ethernet cables, for example. There is another cabling possibility for home automation. Two wire buses like RS-485. A few years ago, I probably would have thought about using such a bus for my home. But with the standardization and the rise of Ethernet, those buses became less and less attractive. So in this video, I will concentrate on Ethernet. The decision for that video was sparked by this board from TTGO. It contains an ESP32 module and an Ethernet connector. We will later see why it has this sticker. By the way, Olimex also has new boards in the shop. What does a typical maker have to know about Ethernet? Here are the most important things. It is a very standardized cable connection that uses RJ45 connectors on both ends. Not like power cables, which have different connectors on both sides. The cables contain four cable pairs, and the newer ones also have shielding against interferences. The pairs have different colors, orange, green, blue, and brown. One wire of a pair has a solid color, the other one not. Two different wire diagrams exist, mainly to confuse us. Flip a coin on which one to use and stick with it, at least for both connectors on one cable, because it does not matter. These days, all wires are connected straight from one side to the other, not crossed. In the old days, we had to use crossed patch cables for specific purposes. Today, the routers and switches have auto-sensing and adapt their pins. Like many other things, Ethernet was invented at Xerox PARC in 1973. And of course, I have to mention that Digital Equipment Corporation, or DEC, one of my early employers, was responsible for its fast distribution in the 1980s. Against IBM's token ring concept, by the way. Back then, the speeds were low, and the cables therefore simple. When speeds increased, cables had to become more sophisticated. To get some order, they started to categorize them using numbers. at the time of making this video, Cat6, Cat6A and Cat7 cables are in focus. As we see on the list, Cat1 to 5 and Cat8 cables exist, but they are not important. Cat1 to 5 are too slow and Cat8 is too expensive and not needed. Most of us will use 1 to 10 gigabits networks for the next years. The difference between Cat6 and 7 is the transmission speed they support, the diameter and the price. Cat6 is suitable for 1 gigabit per second, Cat7 for 10 gigabit per second. You also get Cat6A as a compromise, but the uplift to Cat7 is not significant. So Cat7 is the right choice for new cabling. Fortunately, Ethernet connections are backward compatible. This means you can connect a slow device to a fast device without problems. Even if you connect two fast devices with an old cable, they will work, just slower. So Ethernet is one of the more stable standards, and it is here to stay. We can depend on it. You can buy prefabricated cables, but can also crimp your own. Just some recommendations. Buy a good crimper and a cheap test device to check the wiring of the cable before you use them. Like that, you are sure that the sequence is correct and all wires are connected. And buy the right connectors that match the category of the cable you want to crimp. They are different, even if they are compatible. Ethernet offers another great feature, Power over Internet or POE. If you want to brush up your know-how on that topic, I suggest you watch video number 276 right after this one. In a nutshell, we can use the Ethernet cable to power our devices, which is extremely useful. We do not need a power supply for each device and no second cable. Modern routers like mine support POE. The standard voltage is 48 volts and it provides enough power for most applications. These 48 volts are, by the way, probably the reason for that danger sticker in the area of the POE parts. And now we are back to the ESP32 board. In addition to a standard VROOM module, it has the needed circuit for Ethernet and POE. It also has an SD card reader if you need one. But attention, it does not have a USB to serial chip on board. This means that you either have to order the additional converter or build a cable for your standard adapter. Here is the pinout. Please be aware that the programming connector does not have the standard pin distance of 2.54 mm. Its distance is 2 mm. So I suggest ordering one adapter with your first board. This USB-C socket is only for power, which is not needed in my case because power comes via the Ethernet cable. But how does Ethernet work on the ESP32? It uses the Wi-Fi commands. Very strange indeed. But it is a good idea. As we later will see, you do not need to change your sketch a lot. As a demonstrator, I created an example of a typical application where a BME280 transmits its readings via MQTT. The device also waits for MQTT commands and switches an LED on and off. What are the changes from a Wi-Fi enabled sketch? We have to include this library and to add the pin definitions for the chip. And here we see a function that shows us what happens and also shows us the IP address. In setup, we have to call this function and start the Ethernet with all pins from before. The loop stays more or less the same. Where did I get the sketch from? I combined a few sources and did some tests till it worked. Unfortunately, Ethernet on the ESP32 is not used a lot up till now. Maybe this will change now? The speed on the cable is 100 megabits per second maximum, which is for sure no limit for an IoT device. And what about power consumption and deep sleep? I have to tell you, I don't care about that in this setup because we have enough energy coming through the cable and do not need deep sleep. A warning, I tried to use BLE with Ethernet. Unfortunately, it did not work. I did not investigate why. Maybe you know? Another important remark. Comparing the pins of the breakout connector with the priority pin list of my last video, we see that we only have 6 freely usable pins. And worse, we do not have the standard I2C pins available. Fortunately, the Adafruit library for the BME280 supports free I2C pin assignment. Looking at the Olimex diagram of a similar board, we see that Ethernet uses 8 pins of the ESP32, also the 2 standard I2C pins. Olimex, by the way, uses the LAN 8710 chip and TTGO the 8720. Was it worthwhile for TTGO and Olimex to create new Ethernet boards? What do you think? Summarized. Wired connections have 3 main advantages over wireless networks. Privacy, because it's not easy to hack them. Speed, because it's easier to reach high speeds on a wire than over the air and because the connections do not need to share the same resources. Energy, over a short distance, wired communication need less energy. And with POE, we can power our device without problems. Wireless connections are far more flexible and mobile. Ethernet cables are categorized. Today, I suggest using Cat7 cables for new projects. You can either buy ready-made or crimp your own cables. Select the right connectors and a good crimper, and test all cables before you use them. Fortunately, the ESP32 natively supports Ethernet and an Arduino library exists. Unfortunately, the Ethernet chip needs 8 GPIO pins, which leaves us with 12 usable pins at the breakout connector. Only 6 of them belong to the priority list. Another 4 are input-only pins. GPIO 2 and 12 are strapping pins with special functions. An example sketch connects to the MQTT server via cable, transmits a few sensor readings, and waits for commands to switch an LED or a relay. Ethernet uses the Wi-Fi commands. Strange to read, but very useful because we do not have to adapt our sketches too much. Because we cannot use the standard I2C pins, we have to tweak some libraries if they do not support free pin assignment. All in all, a valid alternative for fixed devices in home automation. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.